Hello everyone, and welcome to my first ever Q&A video for this channel, Creepleets. Thank you to everyone who submitted a question. Even if you haven't submitted a question and you're watching this video, I do appreciate the view. I want to be doing more of these Q&As in the future, so if you do like this, be sure to let me know in the comments, and I'll try to do these a bit more regularly. Not that I'm a super interesting person, but they are a little bit different, and it's a break of pace from general pickup videos and stuff like that, so they're fun for me to do. That being said, let's jump right into these questions. If you see me looking off screen here, it's because my questions are behind the camera, so I kind of have to look away to see them. So these are not in the order that they were given to me. They're basically just in the order that YouTube has decided that it's going to show me them. So I'm going to start from the bottom and work my way to the top. So the first question is from MTShark7. He says, sweet Q&A coming soon. My questions are you planning on doing a game room tour soon? Literally what you see behind me is my game room. I don't have a big game room. I live in basically an apartment, a basement apartment, and I don't have a lot of room to have a game room. So it's just this little wall, what you can see there, my 360 stuff, and then kind of working my way down, and some more stuff here, and some gaming magazines and vinyl. So just regular stuff like that. That's it. That's my game room. I do really like it. I think I have a lot of really good stuff. So I probably will do, like, might show it off in the future. If that's something people are interested in, again, let me know down in the comments. But it is something I'd be willing to do. What consoles do you enjoy collecting for the most and why? Right now I'm really enjoying the PS4. I know it seems really cliche to say that because it's kind of a new system. But I'm really enjoying all the, like, little indie titles and budget titles coming out on physical media. So that's really fun. The limited run games, as much as we all hate that kind of crap, it is fun to be down to the wire and you're on the web page trying to refresh, waiting for stuff to come available. So I find that fun. Other than that, I am collecting a full set of game gear, so I find that intriguing as well. It's a bit more than I thought it would be at the time. So I'm working my way through that, but I guess that would be probably I'll say that as the two. If you had to get rid of one of your consoles and all the games from your collection, which would it be and why? So there's a couple ways to interpret this question. Consoles can be anything like connected to the TV, but it can also be handhelds. There are also consoles that are part of add-ons. So I'm going to do one of each just to hopefully kind of cover the gamut of it. As far as handhelds, if I had to get rid of one handheld, it would be my Neo Geo Pocket. I have one and I have two games for it, and that's the only two games I've ever had for it. I find the system really hard to collect for, and the system is pretty hard to play on as well, so that's probably the one I would get rid of. But some people don't consider handhelds to be consoles. It's a handheld, it's a different category. So we'll go on to another one that I would get rid of would be the Sega 32X. This is, again, another one people wouldn't really consider a console because it's an add-on. So whatever, I will put it that way. The 32X, I think, is just a bit of a tumor. I find it really, really interesting, and I find the games interesting to look at and to play around for a bit, but not something that I would really, you know, delve into and play over and over and over and, you know, really get into the system, unlike many other people out there who really enjoy the system. But yeah, that would be that one. But if it had to be an actual console, like standalone by itself, probably the Sega Saturn, and I know that's a big flop. It's just, I have no, what do you say, emotional attachment or nostalgia for the Sega Saturn. It's not a system I grew up with. It's one that I've kind of been infatuated with since being part of the retro gaming community. I find it really interesting to collect for, but again, it's really hard to get games for. It's expensive, it's a pain to hook up, just stuff like that. So I think I would be okay letting that one go if I had to. The next questions are from Party Play Gaming. Question one, who would win in a fight between Miles from Flock of Nerds versus a double Filet-O-Fish from McDonald's? I don't know, man, those Filet-O-Fishes are pretty rough. I think Miles could handle it. I think I'll put my bets on Miles in that one, if you could hold that one down. Question two, who is your childhood hero? And then in brackets, video game character, superhero, comic, TV show, or family? This is, again, as far as heroes go, I haven't had a whole lot. I would say probably my dad for the long term. you know, when you're a kid, you're embarrassed by your dad, and even sometimes now I'm embarrassed by my dad. But that being said, he's done a lot of great things, and he's been a big role model, despite what I've thought of him in the past. And I don't get me wrong, I love my dad. But yeah, he's always been out there to do what's best for his family and do what's best for us as we were growing up, and he's still doing that now to this day. So he's doing stuff that he doesn't really want to do, but he has to do because that's part of being a dad. So yeah, I think I'll be with my dad. And are they still someone you look up to and continue to read about or watch today? I think I kind of answered that question, Fraser. I'm assuming Fraser is asking that question. So yeah, definitely my dad. Scott the Canadian asks, any missed gaming deals, like someone beat you to a game before you could get it? This happens daily on Kijiji. There's always something I see, and I'm like, oh, I want that, and I write to get it, and it's gone. I can give a couple examples. One was on Kijiji. Someone had the Nintendo World Championships, Panic Restaurant, Little Samson, and a couple other ones. I think Earthbound, whatever. And they just put them up. They're like, oh, $5 each. Just want to get rid of them. And I was like, oh, and I wrote really, really quickly. It hadn't shown any visits on the ad yet. So I thought for sure I would have had it. And then by the time the guy got back to me, like maybe 5 or 6 hours later, he said, oh, they're kind of available, but I'm getting a lot of offers for them. So they're not 500, or they're not $5 anymore. They're a lot more. And I'm like, oh, so what are you looking at? Like, I'll give you $20 for all of them. And he was like, no, I'm looking more at like 700 for the total, 800 for the total, stuff like that. I'm like, whoa, I can't do that. That's a little too much for me. So that was a little infuriating. Another one is here in Kitchener, Value Village. Back when I first started, I used to go to Value Village every day. And I missed out on Earthbound and Chrono Trigger to a local guy who also collects video games and sells video games. I think it was Chrono Trigger. Anyways, I know Earthbound for sure was in there, and I think he got it for like $8. That was a little sad. I'd really love to get Earthbound. Not that I ever will, but you know, it's one of those things. And probably another one was I walked into a Value Village and I saw someone holding a stack of games, and they had their kid with them. And I know they're buying them for their kids, so I can't really be angry, but I mean, they had Mega Man Legends 1 and 2, Eternal Darkness, Fire Emblem on the Wii, Killer 7 on the GameCube, like just a bunch of stuff. I'm like, ah, like if I had been here 5 minutes earlier, this would have been different. I would have had these. But like I said, I can't really get it too upset. It's for kids, so hopefully they enjoy it and they've had fun with it. Longshot asks, what's the craziest thing you've done to get a hold of certain games? This is part of a two-part question, so I'll answer this one first. The craziest thing I've done to do for a game hasn't been anything really serious. I mean, I've waited up for late at night to get pre-orders. I think it's not that crazy. I think everyone does that. Probably the craziest thing I've done for like video game related would be my Wii U. If you haven't seen my Wii U story, I think I did that when I was with Game Hunters R Us. But I'll do a quick recap here. Basically, I'm on part of a Facebook group, a local Facebook group for video games, and I saw that one of them had posted that Target, when Target was still in Canada, this was a while ago, had their Wii U's on clearance for $150, and that is like stupid cheap, brand new, $150, and I really, really, really wanted a Wii U, so I contacted this person, asked them to send me a picture of their receipt, and then I basically went around trying to price match at other places. I got laughed out of Walmart and Best Buy, so needless to say, I wasn't a big fan of those companies at that time. So basically what I ended up having to do was drive. After dinner one night, like I was following this thread and people were just going nuts. Okay, where do I go? Where do I go? And basically it was at a Target out in, I think it's Elora. Like it was a ways away. It was like at least 45 minutes away from my house. So I just decided, you know what, screw it, I'm going to take the chance. I hopped in the car, and this was like during a snowstorm, it was stupid. So I drove all the way out to Elora, and I found that they had a couple of Wii U's there. There was like 6 or 8 of them still there, and I was really, really, really tight on cash. And a lot of people are going to be like, oh, if you were tight on cash, why were you buying it? You know what, I'm a gamer and I'm a collector, and sometimes I'm human and I'm stupid and I make stupid mistakes. So I managed to scrounge together enough money between my cash and my Visa, and I basically managed to buy two of these Wii U's because they were such a good deal. And then I basically brought them both back to Kitchener, and I sold one. I put the other one up on Kijiji at full price, or just a little bit under full price to hopefully entice someone to buy it, and I sold it the next day. So I ended up only really spending about 50 to 60 bucks on my own personal Wii U, which was a lot more palatable than the 150, even though 150 was a good deal. And that was even a better deal than the 300 that it normally would have been. So, yeah, that's probably the craziest thing I've ever done for something video game related. And I'm sorry that was a really long question. A really long answer. Do you see your video game collection changing once your baby is born? So if you haven't heard, yes, I am having a child. Who's due in the end of January. So it's going to be a huge transformation in my life and my wife's life. And things are going to be pretty crazy around here. As far as collecting goes, I think having a baby definitely will change collections. Obviously, my priorities are going to be towards that, more family duties and things like that. I'm not going to be buying as much. I'll probably be selling a bit more out of my collection just because it's a lot of fluff and I'm just trying to get rid of a bunch of it. And a lot of that is going to go out at the Wireless Video Game Swap. Which is coming up on the October, not October, September 25th, this coming weekend. This video should be up before that, hopefully. And so I'm clearing out a bunch of stuff, and you can see my 360 stuff. Like that was full, and you can see there's games leaned over. I've pulled games out, and I'm gonna sell them off because I either have no interest in them anymore, or I will just never get around to playing them. So that's definitely gonna be it. I'm gonna basically slow down a lot and just buy stuff that I'm really interested in. And not a whole bunch of filler, which I should be doing anyway, but like I said, I'm human and I make stupid decisions sometimes. Game Rescue. I'm gonna say thanks to Game Rescue. I didn't even realize Game Rescue is still watching my videos, so thank you very much, dude, for watching my videos. And you need to put up a video too soon at some point. What retro gaming console S consoles would you like to add to your collection? Not much. I think I have all the retro consoles that I'm really interested. I'm gonna give a bit of a cheat answer here and probably say the Retron 5. I realize it's not retro, but it plays retro games. That's probably one I really want to play. Being in the apartment that I'm in, not a whole lot of room to have all of my modern consoles and all of my retro consoles out at the same time. So having a Retron 5 would just make things so much easier, and I could just pop stuff out and play. I haven't been playing a whole lot of games recently, just because, again, it's such a hassle to have to come home and hook something up after work and then try to play it for a little bit and get some enjoyment. And then if you end up not liking it, then you're gonna try to find something else to play and back and forth. And this is just my opinion right now, and that'll change at some point. So, yeah, that would be my answer. I guess I could say the Sega Nomad would be cool. That would be something I'd be interested in having at some point. DC Redaya. Who is your favorite YouTuber? I feel like this is a loaded question. I feel like I really can't really answer that question. I have too many that I really enjoy. A lot of my friends here are on Facebook, and I'm friends with them on Facebook, but also on YouTube. Yeah, there's a lot out there. As far as someone right now that I'm really watching more and more and more, probably Derek H. I've really been enjoying his videos. Aside from, like I said, all the regular guys I have been watching, I still really enjoy your videos. But right now, like Derek H is, as soon as he posts something, I'm watching it. I find him really insightful and helpful in figuring out like new and obscure video games that I've never heard of before. So I like that, and he's entertaining to listen to. He's got good stories. If you could live in any video game world, what would it be? Probably GTA 5 Online. like with the respawn and everything like that, yeah, definitely that would GTA 5 would be nuts. So you could just drive around, do whatever the heck you wanted, and if you died, oh well, give it a couple seconds and you're back to it. Canadian Retro, I would say Canadian Retro is one of my favorite YouTubers as well. Pick any system and your favorite games of each genre from that system. Oh gosh, this is a really big question. Okay, I'll go with the 360 because I think 360 is what I've had the most time playing. Okay, and your favorite games of each genre from that system. So we gave a bunch here. Racing, probably Forza 4 would probably be my favorite racing game. Sports, NBA Jam. And there's also NFL Arcade. That's like an arcade game. It's a really, really cool. I don't like football in general, but that was a really fun game, and I remember playing that over and over with my friends. RPG. I don't think I've ever played any RPGs on the 360, so I can't really say that. Beat 'em up. Have I played a beat 'em up on the 360? Don't think I have, to be honest. I can't really answer that. Platformer, Super Meat Boy, puzzle, Zuma. Have you ever played Zuma? It's like there's a bunch of like spiral balls, and you're like a little toad guy, and you gotta like shoot balls around and try to match three or four of each, and they disappear, and you gotta get rid of all of them before they reach the end. Really got into that. Like third person shooter, I'll go with Gears of War because that was one of the games that really got me back into gaming. He didn't answer these; he just said etc. I'm trying to think of other genres. Yeah, that's all I can think of right now. So sorry, Ukrainian Retro, if I didn't answer your question very much. Liquid Wayno, if your last name was Loblaws, like the grocery store, and you had a son, who would you name him? Bob? Question. If that's a question, I would say no. But he continues, says, go ahead, say his full name. So Bob Loblaws. There you go. Buried on Mars asked me, how did you like Stubbs the Zombie? I'll admit, I haven't played a whole lot of Stubbs the Zombie. I popped it in for about 10-15 minutes, and it was really fun what I enjoyed of it, or what I played of it. I do have to go back and play that. Flock of Nerds, you've done a channel with a partner, and you've done a channel solo. Which do you prefer? Well, I'll go through all the questions. What are the strengths and weaknesses of each? What have you learned about starting a new YouTube channel from scratch after Game Hunters R Us ended? So yes, this is a, kind of like a brand new start. Which do I prefer between a partner and a channel, a partner channel and a solo channel? Probably a solo channel. It's a lot easier. I can have my own upload schedule. I can kind of do whatever I want, and I don't have to run it by other people and try to figure out, okay, does this kind of match what you want? Does this match what I want? Things like that. Scheduling just makes it a lot easier in that sense. Again, like he said, what are the strengths and weaknesses of each? Like I said, it's really easy for me to just kind of put out what I want to put out, and I don't have to run things by anybody, and I can upload whenever I want. I don't have to be set to a schedule and things like that. But the weaknesses are, I think a lot of people like on the YouTube, I think they like partner channels, they like duos and things like that. It's really nice to have like a back and forth between two people on a video rather than me just talking to a camera like I am now. There's a bit of a bit more of a back and forth, and I think audiences really appreciate that. It feels like they're watching more of a natural conversation rather than me trying to entertain you by just looking at a camera. I think I went through both. Weaknesses of both. Like I said, it's really hard to both be on the same page about some things. When I was with Game Hunters R Us, that sounds really weird saying now. When I was with Game Hunters R Us, it was a bit different because Ben and I were always trying to figure out, okay, when can we put another video? What kind of video do we want to put out? Things like that. We'd get together and then we'd basically have to go over, okay, what are we going to talk about? How are we going to do this? And it was a bit more, I want to say, it was a bit more of a hassle. I was, not that it was hard, but it was just a bit more of a hassle to do that. And especially because we don't really live super close to each other, and we're trying to both put out bit content at the same time. When we were together, it was great, but being apart, and he would put out a video, and I would put out a video, and things like that, it'd be hard to be like, okay, are you putting out a video? Because I'd like to put one out, and just stuff like that. It's a lot more organizing than I think it would be worth. What have you learned about starting a new YouTube channel from scratch after Game Hunters R Us? It's a lot harder nowadays. When I was with Game Hunters R Us, when I started, or when we started Game Hunters R Us, it was really easy. I think it was a prime time in the YouTube gaming community market where people were looking at shows like that. There was Retro Hunters and Game Hunters or Game Chasers. And people like that who were people watch that and they're like, oh, I really want to do this. Pat the NES Punk had started his going to swap meets and stuff like that. So people were looking for that kind of content. And I thought I was late to the game, but apparently I was in a good spot because we grew really, really quickly, fairly quickly. We were at over 100 subs in under a year. And by the time we ended Game Hunters R Us, we were almost at 500 subscribers. So I mean, we were at a good spot, and a lot of people still recognize me from Game Hunters R Us. So I think we made a bit of an impact from there. That being said, when you start a new channel, it's really hard. We put up a video at the end of the Game Hunters R Us saying, you know what, we've decided to just kind of stop this. It's a bit more hassle than we anticipated. So we're just going to stop, and I'm going to start my own channel and do my own thing. And a bunch of those 450 people, or 400, almost 500 people, a lot of them didn't come over. So not that I'm not appreciative of the 154 subscribers that I have right now, but I find it's a lot of a slower grind nowadays than it was back in the day. So there you go. That's my answer to that. Crack asks, what dream motorcycle question. He actually asked me this in our Game Hunters R Us Q&A, so it's a bit of a, I think you're cheating here, Crack. You're asking the same questions too many times. And I'll probably give the same answer then. Actually, I'm gonna give two answers. Real life dream motorcycle, Ducati Multistrada. I love traveling and I want something that's fun and sporty, but I can go anywhere on. So that would be that Ducati Multistrada. But as far as like, if I could have any motorcycle, I want that light cycle from Tron. That looks pretty sweet. Favorite musical artists. I kind of touched on this on my half and half video. I listen to a bunch of people, mostly into like hip hop right now. So I'm listening to a lot of Childish Gambino, a lot of Logic, Schoolboy Q I'm into right now. So that kind of thing. But I mean, as far as like all-time favorites, like I said, Linkin Park has been always been there. I realize it's a bit of a cheesy answer, but that's what it is. Would you rather cook an awesome meal or go out for one? I would rather go out for a meal. I love eating out. Love going out. The atmosphere and getting to see outside of your own kitchen, whatever. I like going to see new places and stuff like that. So probably that. And have you ever farted in a setting that was either uncomfortable or inappropriate? If so, how did you handle it? So here's a bit of a story about me. I actually like I think farting is gross. I'm not a f I don't like people who fart around me. I'm not a f I'm not digging that. Which is kind of weird because a lot of people, like a lot of my friends, do it in front of by me because I know it bugs me. So I it's not a secret I like to get out there, but you know, here I am confessing it on the interweb of YouTube. So I find like channels like Game Chasers, when they start farting and burping and stuff, I'm just like, I tune out. That's disgusting. And what started this, and this is kind of the whole thing, is when I lived overseas and I was driving with my dad in a truck, I had some really, really bad gas. Like when you're eating stuff over there, like you're eating some village food and stuff like that, it can get kind of messy, and you know, your stomach's not always used to what you're eating. So whatever, I ate some weird stuff. And my stomach didn't like it, and we had the, of course, it's hot as hell, so you're blasting the AC, you're trapped in this little cage going down a bumpy road, and I had to let one go, and I was just like, oh, it just went. Anyways, my dad actually was not happy with me because he had to smell it the entire way back, and he was just like, he's like, did you just do that? And I was like, yeah, I'm sorry, like, it's just like, he's like, don't ever fart in the car, especially when the windows are closed. Like, that's something you gotta keep that under wraps. I was like, oh, okay. Like, I was young, I was probably 8 or 9. I was probably like 10 o'clock, or 10, probably something like that. Anyway, so ever since then, it's just been like, I've really struggled to like control myself. So if I'm out somewhere and I gotta, you know, I gotta fart. I understand it's a bodily function, people gotta do it. But you know, I will hold that sucker in. I'm not letting that one go. Anyways, that's a long answer about something that I don't really like talking about. Deej, I don't know how to say your name, Derek. You need to tell me how to say your name at some point. Deej 13 from Two Dorks. What's up with the Captain America? I always try to switch up what shirts I'm wearing, and sometimes I just forget what I've already worn. So it apparently it looks like I just wear Captain America all the time. So I'm sorry, I will not wear that one for a while. Chris Miller, what are some games in your backlog? These games are in my backlog. I am playing these ones. Yeah, I have too many games. What are some of your collecting goals? So I think a lot of people already know this. I am going for a full Game Gear North America set, not completed box or anything like that. Just loose, and if I can get manuals with them, that's cool too. So yeah, that's about it. Daniel Koper, what got you into doing YouTube videos and collecting video games? This is kind of another interesting story. I basically really got into retro games a lot because of, like I said, Ben, who I was doing Game Hunters R Us with. But also, I was in university when I did this. I did college and I worked for 7 years after my college career, and then I decided I didn't want to do what I was doing anymore. So I went back to university. And I think it was first year university, I just got really bored doing all of my same assignments over and over and over. So I would just go on YouTube and try to figure stuff out and watch some videos, blah, blah, blah. And I stumbled upon garage selling videos, saw people collecting games, and I was talking to Ben, and we were going about over our old memories of playing games and stuff like that. So I basically kind of used getting into YouTube and collecting games kind of in the same time. I think I was watching the Retro Hunters, and I really liked what they were doing. So I decided, you know what? I was taking a break from some of my school assignments. I went to a Goodwill. I found a couple of games, and I got really pumped by it. And I was like, I want to do this more. I want to do this more. And I found a bunch of stuff. And so I just started doing, like I said, collecting more and more and more. And I ended up talking to Ben, and we were talking about, oh, we kind of want to start a YouTube channel. We wanted to do more of a Let's Play, but it kind of turned into video game pickups. Because that's kind of what I was into. So that's basically what it became. So it was kind of an escape from school, I will say, is what it is. And I've just kind of continued it. I've graduated from university for over 2 years now, so here I am still collecting games. So, Musty Hobbit, any odd items you find yourself collecting non-video game related? I collect a lot of junk. I'm As far as odd stuff, not so much. I collect a lot of motorcycle parts just for no reason. I have dreams of making motorcycles and mini bikes and stuff like that. So anytime I find something cool, I'll bring it home and I put it in the garage and I just kind of leave it there. And yeah, that's basically it. I also collect like random comic books. I'm just like, this looks really dumb. I'm gonna buy it. So yeah, that's probably it. Milo the Gathering. Miles is sneaking in here with another question. You said you grew up overseas in a recent video. Where exactly was that? Keep it real. So again, a bit of a different story here. I moved overseas to a country called Burkina Faso in West Africa. Contrary to popular belief, Africa is not a country. It is a continent, and there are multiple countries within that continent. So Burkina Faso is one of those countries. My parents worked with a nonprofit organization. We moved there when I was 9 years old. In 1997. So we lived there for many, many years. We moved back here officially, or I moved back here officially in 2001, 2002. No, that doesn't sound right. No, I moved back officially in 2006. I think it was 2006. Anyways, it was a decent time. It was like roughly 7 or 8 years that I spent over there. A lot of my formative years, so like I moved there when I was 9, and I basically came back when I was like 17, 18. So, like over the course of a couple years, also there was time off in between. I know the math doesn't add up, but trust me, in total, it was like roughly about that time, because there was time we came back for some, and then we went back over, so back and forth. It's a little confusing. Sorry, Miles, if that's confusing. So yeah, nonprofit. We lived in a village for some of the time. We lived in the capital city. We had two houses, so we'd go back and forth. We'd spend 2 weeks in the village, then we'd spend 2 weeks in the capital, 2 weeks in the village. So I ran around with a slingshot. I shot lizards and bats and stuff like that. We ate them. We went out in the bush and stuff. I had a pet monkey. I had a dog. I was riding around on motorcycles and bikes, and yeah, it was just nuts. Like we also did a bike trip up to the Sahara Desert. We were riding around there, and we came back. That was a long. We didn't. None of us showered for like 5 days. That was gross. But yeah, just stuff like that. It's pretty nuts. So yeah, hopefully that answers your questions. If you have more, Miles, I'm sure you can talk to me at some point. We can kind of go over it more. And the last question is from NeoSolid22. What is the highest price you paid for a retro game? As far as retro games, probably about $70 is about the most I spent on a retro game. I'll probably end up spending more. Like I said, I'm going for a Game Gear set, and Mega Man for the Game Gear is not cheap, so gonna have to find a way through that. So $70 I spent for Secret of Mana on the Super Nintendo. It's one I really, really wanted to try, especially co-op with some friends. So we're gonna run with that. But the highest price I paid for a game in general is about $100. Yeah, I'll leave it at that. So like I said, thank you very much everyone who asked me questions. I'd love to do more of these, so if you're interested, let me know down in the comments, like I said. Or if you have any more questions, throw them down in the comments at some point, and I can kind of refer back to them when I make another Q&A video if there's enough desire to have it. So that's going to do it for me, so I will see you guys all in the next one. Later.